trying to give this talk in as many places as I can. I've given it to the correctional officers at the Franklin County House of Corrections. I've given it to the court at the Franklin District Court. I've given it to the hospital, to the Grand Rounds, to the medical staff. I'm giving it at Bay State Medical Center. I'm giving it Cooley Dickinson. So I'm trying to target many different populations that interact with individuals who are struggling with the disease of addiction. But who am I really giving it to? I'm actually giving it to this room, because in this room, and I know probably 80% of you, this is the crowd that's actually running the county in this room. It just is. I know where most of you work, and this is the room that has the power to actually make major changes in how we view this disease and how we can help people more, because as all of you know, this is a terribly hard disease to treat. So the first thing I'm going to say is that this slide here, that addiction is a brain disease and it matters, comes from 1998. It was a relatively impactful article. People were a little bit surprised by it. At that time, it was based on 20 years of research. The point of this being that the research done on the brain and the way that addiction damages the brain is really new stuff. And I'll tell you, I think we know about 20% of the story. We know so much about cardiovascular disease and actually most types of cancer. We know everything there is, it seems to me, about women's reproductive health. We know lots. We can always get better there. But my point is that there is a lot to be uncovered still. And so I'm trying to present the best, most up-to-date data I have, but the whole story could change in another 5 years. We're going to spend time looking at the actual brain. I want nobody to get anxious or like high school biology trauma regression happening here, but the brain, very simple. I'm only going to cover the reward circuit, so I'm going to spend time talking about the nucleus accumbens, the prefrontal cortex, and the ventral tegmental area. The reward center is the pleasure center of the brain. This is it's one of the problems with the disease of addiction, is that this is one of the oldest, most deeply held parts of the brain. It's a part of the brain that becomes very hard to change because it is very wrapped up in your overall survival. So I think of it like the lizard brain. So this part of the brain tells you to eat, drink, and have sex. That's the point of this brain. It says in order to survive, you need to find clean water. You need to find some food that will help you survive another day on this cold planet, and you need to spread your genetic wealth down many generations. So you need to have a lot of sex. That's the point of this part of the brain. It's been very useful for 200,000 years. It is a lot less useful when it is applied to any of the drugs, and I'm talking the wide scope of drugs, cocaine, marijuana, nicotine, alcohol, sugar, sex, gambling, anything that's addictive interacts with this part of the brain. So the reward circuit, again, I've covered the fact that what we're mainly talking about is the prefrontal cortex. That's the part of the brain that teenagers haven't developed till they're 24, right? It's actually the brake side of the brain. It's the thing that says, oh, I should slow down. But when you're a teenager, it's all about putting on the gas and pressing down on the accelerator. So the prefrontal cortex, not developed in the younger brain, interacts with the nucleus accumbens and the ventral tegmental area. The problem is the amygdala and the hippocampus. And if you look at where those little colored lines go, those colored lines represent neurotransmitters between all of those spots. They all connect to the hippocampus and the amygdala. And the hippocampus and the amygdala modulate memory and emotion. So again, here you have this incredibly deep survival part of the brain, your most ancient part of the brain, and it interacts with emotion and with memory. So you can imagine if you were a child, let's say, with terrible trauma, and in fact, that part of your brain is constantly activated with negative emotion and sadness and grief and getting triggered of a sense that I am vulnerable all the time and no one is there to care for me, you would want to shut that down. And there is nothing that will numb you up better than drugs and alcohol. That's why a lot of people with a history of trauma will turn to drugs and alcohol. And there's a very high correlation between addiction and adverse childhood events, and we're going to spend some time talking about that. But it's also the reason why walking into a place that you have always known, the place where you used to score your drugs, or literally for one of my patients, the Wendy's bathroom, just the smell of Wendy's makes him want to use so badly because it has a very positive emotion for him, and it feeds into that memory circuit. So that sense of seeing the same things or sensing a smell or going back to your old neighborhood in Northfield where you used to use, it is very hard to return to that neighborhood again and in any way be able to be sober. Again, you're seeing why it is when you look at those pathways. So I'm not going to spend tons of time on serotonin, but there's two main chemicals in the brain that make you feel good. Serotonin, right? Its levels are low when you're depressed or anxious. It's why we use SSRIs or selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors to help with depression. But also dopamine. Dopamine is that drug that makes you feel awesome. So the dopamine pathways run exactly in those three areas. I'm not going to quiz you, but the VTA, the nucleus accumbens, and the prefrontal cortex. And they manage reward, euphoria, pleasure, compulsion, and perseveration. Because guess what? 100,000 years ago, you needed to perseverate about how you were going to get food, water, and have sex. It makes sense. You really want your brain to be compulsive about it, because otherwise you wouldn't have survived. But apply that to drugs. You know, people act, and it's not just people who are ignorant. It is people who actually are ignorant, but people who, sadly, are governors of states. Let's take the state of Maine. They act as though it is just a weakness of character, right? It's a moral failing because they seem unwilling to educate themselves about the fact that part of the compulsion and the perseveration, sitting at the Franklin County House of Correction, you can be there for a year, but a lot of that year, you're thinking about what it's going to be like to be free and out of that place and thinking again and again about what it would be like to either light up a cigarette again, even though you've been off your nicotine for a whole year, or actually shoot up again. It's part of that brain that gets triggered. Again, if we could have chosen drugs and alcohol to work in anywhere else in the brain, that would have been much better than where it lands. It lands again in this deepest part of your brain. It's very hard to repair. So this is me on my most every day, because I'm a really happy person who has been gifted with everything, quite honestly. And I wake up every day feeling pretty awesome, and I feel that way most of the day. I have really high dopamine levels. I think at a baseline, that's just who I am, and I think there's other people in this room who feel that way too. Having said that, we know lots of people who don't feel that way. And I have patients who are like this. I may have a kid who's like this, but they are sort of glass half empty, a little bit like Eeyore. And their dopamine levels at a baseline are just on the low side. That's who they are. But you can imagine then, if your baseline units of dopamine is 100, and then you eat like the best flourless chocolate cake with a perfect red raspberry on it, and you get yourself up to a dopamine of 150, and then you have awesome sex and you get yourself to 200, cocaine will bring you to 350, right? Heroin or most of the potent opiates, if you're snorting it or injecting it, will get you to 500. And then you use methamphetamines or crystal meth, and you get between 1,200 and 1,300 units of dopamine. So the question is, why the heck aren't all of you out, like, using some methamphetamines right now? Because that's awesome, right? Why aren't more of us trying to get more dopamine in our brain? Because it really works, right? For a little while, it looks just like this. So I'm not going to torture you with these slides in great detail, but I am going to show you a couple slides that actually remind you why it is that some of these drugs work on dopamine. It's all a simple equation. It has to do with what your amount of dopamine is available. It has to do with how many receptors there are to receive the dopamine. And the third component is time. When you add those three things up, it's why my dopamine levels are high. I've got something along that equation that's running pretty nicely. Maybe I have all three at a slightly higher level. So the way cocaine works is it allows time to be longer. So it gets rid of the component of the neurotransmitter that recycles cocaine, so it sits in that little synaptic cleft longer. So cocaine prolongs dopamine being there. That's why cocaine works. Heroin is a slightly different pathway, but the bottom end of the day, what it does is it just produces more dopamine in the body. I'm not going to do this for all drugs, but most every single drug is increasing the amount of dopamine in your brain. The problem with a dopamine of 350 or 500 or 1300 is the brain thinks that is crazy, right? It is not meant to ever be that much dopamine in your brain. Your brain is supposed to maybe get a peak of 200, right? Great sex plus chocolate cake. Maybe you got yourself to 220. I have no idea. But the point is that when the brain starts to see these huge levels of dopamine, it says something's wrong here. I need to quiet it down. I need to turn down this very loud volume. So I'm going to do one of three things. I'm going to stop producing dopamine. I'm going to take away the receptors for dopamine, or I'm going to increase my recycler. So I'm going to suck the dopamine back out of the synaptic cleft faster. That's what the brain does to fix that loud level of dopamine, and it does it universally. Nobody gets high and stays high for years on end, right? People will say, you know, I had the best 3 or 6 months of my life, and then it was over. So again, that top chart, normal baseline, you have an orgasm, you return to your baseline. With somebody with an addiction, you have a baseline that's a little bit different, you get high, you crash way down, way below where you ever wanted to be. So most people who are struggling actively with the disease of addiction are having dopamine levels on a daily basis that are probably 30 to 50. It's hard to get out of bed and get showered and show up at your doctor appointment on time. And actually be nice to your probation officer or be nice to my office staff when your dopamine level is 30. You're actually pretty mean and unpleasant a lot of the time, not just because you're withdrawal, but because you feel terrible. Your brain feels terrible and you will do anything to improve upon that. So it leads to this, the broken brain. So healthy subject, so that's a brain that has a lot of yellow and orange. The orange is really representing dopamine, and on the other side of it is the somebody with an addiction. So you see very low levels of dopamine. I'm not going to torture you with PET scans, but if you Google image drug abuse and PET scans, there are millions of examples of these. This is just another example, the column in the control column on the left. But those are healthy brains where you see a lot of orange. Those are all dopamine. And then you look at the people with addiction on the right. Who has any orange left in them? People with an alcohol addiction have a little bit of dopamine going on because alcohol actually interacts with GABA, a slightly different neurotransmitter. But the rest of those brains are not experiencing much dopamine release. I'm definitely not going to torture you with the rat brain picture. When I do this talk to Grand Rounds, I actually spend a long time with the medical people sort of going through all this. But the bottom line is that every drug out there is interacting with this part of the brain. Amphetamines, cocaine, opiates, cannabinoids, right? When people talk about legalizing marijuana and having our 14-year-olds smoke as much weed as they want, you've got to ask yourself what part of the brain is being impacted. Right? And what does it mean long-term for those brains, particularly today's marijuana, which is not what people were smoking in the 1970s. Alcohol, barbiturates, benzodiazepams. Massachusetts is the number 4 prescriber of benzodiazepams. Drugs like Valium, Xanax, clonazepam, also called Clonopin, Ativan, number 4 prescriber in the country. We hand out benzos like crazy, and we act like it's no big deal, but they are very dependency-inducing drugs, and they're very hard to get off of. So let's spend a minute talking about any other disease in the body where there is messaging systems gone awry, because other than infectious disease, every disease in your body has to do with messaging systems gone awry. I'm going to give what I think is a fairly simple example, and that is diabetes. So in that top slide is what a healthy pancreas does. A healthy pancreas makes insulin. Insulin goes to insulin receptors and tells the insulin receptors to suck glucose out of the bloodstream into the cell. That's the way our bodies work when we don't have diabetes. When you have type 1 diabetes, the pancreas stops making insulin, just like the brain stops making dopamine. When you have type 2 diabetes, there's actually usually enough insulin around, but the insulin receptors are no longer working. And in both those circumstances, type 1 and type 2, you have blood sugar or glucose hanging out in the bloodstream outside of a cell. So how is this any different than those neurotransmitter slides I showed you? It isn't. I could show slide after slide of every disease, and it looks exactly the same. Having said that, in our emergency room, the gentleman who's in the top there with crushing substernal chest pain shows up in our ER, right? He has a ST-depressed MI. They call Bay State because they know this guy's in bad shape. They give him his aspirin, his beta blocker. They put him in a cardiac care truck, and they rush him down to Bay State. They may cath him. They may not. They may go straight to quintuple bypass on this guy. He ends up in the cardiac care unit. He's there for 5 days. He's on the floor for 5 to 7 days. He gets a social work consult because everybody knows men with heart attacks, they're going to get depressed. easily $60,000 gets spent on this guy. He gets cardiac rehab afterwards for 8 weeks, a free gym membership, good therapy, and some good antidepressants, and his life was saved. Now let's talk about him for a minute. He's overweight. He has a terrible diet. He eats at McDonald's all the time. He's a two-pack-a-day smoker. He has bad genetics. He knew his genetics. His mom and his dad both died in their 50s of a heart attack. Anybody play a shame and blame guy with the game with this guy in the ER? Did anybody stop and wag their finger at him before they shipped him off to his quintuple bypass? Of course they didn't. They provided him the best medical care available, period. The woman, on the other hand, is a young woman who overdoses. She's given Narcan in the field. She revives for a while. She crashes again. She's on the ambulance. She's given Narcan again in the ER. They hold her for 4 hours. They ask her if she wants treatment. They have crisis come over and evaluate her. There's no real beds available. There's no detox beds. There's no 21-day beds. There's no long-term beds. They don't call primary care. They don't call her therapist. They don't offer her any other treatment options. So she goes back out within half a day, and she's using again. The 30, 60, and 90-day mortality is much higher for that woman than it is for that man. And we provided one of those people top-of-the-line medical care in this great nation of ours, and we provided the other one basically nothing. It's really an unacceptable state of affairs. And I have to say, one of the reasons I like to give this talk, or why it became important to me, is I think I love Massachusetts. I'm a Massachusetts North Quabbin girl. This is where I'm from. And I think we are the smartest, thinking out of the box part of this great state of ours. And I think we can get so much better than this. We should be leading the entire country in terms of being able to offer treatment to people who suffer from this disease. And part of it is I want you guys to take this talk and I want you to spread the word. I want everybody to understand the disease of addiction as well as I do or more than I do. Again, the rat brain, scary rat brain. And the reason I'm going to talk about this is because what happens, though, with addiction is that once you get rid of one addiction, the way the brain works, because, again, all of these same chemicals are all rotating through the same reward center in the brain, once you get rid of something, something else will often take its place. So for just a minute, if you look at alcohol and you stop drinking alcohol because you decide you're struggling with alcohol, you often will develop a disease of addiction to something else. So any AA meeting, what are people struggling with at most AA meetings? Some of which are bad for you, some of which are not. Smoking, right? There's a high preponderance of nicotine abuse, okay? What else is there? Coffee, caffeine. Caffeine is an addiction. Is it terrible for you? No, actually, caffeine's probably good for you. The studies look at 4 to 5 8-ounce cups a day as being actually healthful, longer, lowest rates of mortality with 4 to 5 8-ounce cups a day. So caffeine is an addiction that I guess could lead you down the bad path if you really, really, really drink too much, but for the most part, it's not that bad. And then the third one that I think of, sugar. Wow, you guys are good. So there's your little sugar addiction, gambling addiction, sex addiction. The addiction could be anything that you want it to be. And I'm going to just put this slide up. I'm not going to go through this slide. This is the American Society of Addiction Medicine's definition of addiction. It's way too long. But what I want to point out is that genetics account for 50% of addiction development. So the average parent who's suffering, struggling with an addiction, whether it's to alcohol or to something else, 50% of the time that will be passed on to their kids. There is no disease you guys can name that has that level of genetic predisposition. Nothing. Nothing. I mean, people act like breast cancer is that genetic. Like 3% of breast cancer is truly genetic. That's very low rates. But 50% with addiction. A history of trauma or stressors that overwhelm an individual's coping abilities. That's very, very common with this disease. Often the presence of a co-occurring psychiatric illness. When you ask the average teenager, like, why did you start? They'll often say, I felt so terrible, I was so depressed, or my anxiety was so bad that this is the thing that made me feel normal. And then the final is just the impaired executive function, so that perception, learning, impulse control, compulsivity, and judgment are impaired. It's part of the disease. So we can all get really mad at somebody who relapses, or you could take a deep breath and say, wow, this is part of the disease, and I'm going to work with it. So I actually always use the short version of my definition of addiction: compulsive use, loss of control, continued use despite harm, and having cravings. Somebody, when I walked in, talked about the article that was in the paper. I only wrote that article because the inmates of the Franklin County House of Corrections and GCC professors wrote such a fabulous article that I just wanted to chime in. But one of my friends back there said, the best line of that letter was the fact that you said addiction is a pediatric disease. And I actually think that most pediatricians probably, they wouldn't argue with us on this one, but they kind of don't really want to have to own this because it's a big thing to own. But look at where the numbers start to climb. So age of first use of alcohol is the blue line, nicotine is the red line, and marijuana is the green line. And it's really starting at age 10 and 11, it starts to climb. A lot of people I work with who really, really struggle, whether it's at the House of Corrections or it's in my own practice, they started using their first drug at 7, 8, or 9. And I'm not talking small amounts. They started drinking vast amounts of alcohol, vast amounts of marijuana or nicotine at 7, 8, and 9, right? That's 3rd, 4th, and 5th grade. So look at how high those numbers get in those adolescent years. And in fact, all addiction starts in adolescence. And I say that with one caveat being alcohol. There is a second peak of alcohol starting and becoming a problem, and that is men in their 60s. And so I don't laugh about that because it's not ideal, but it's sort of the post-retired guy who's at home and his wife's about to kill him. And that's not a good time to actually turn to alcohol, but it often can happen. Otherwise, you know, 98%, if you're going to smoke, you start before 23 or 26, done. If you aren't smoking by 26, you'll never smoke. So I am going to spend a little bit of time on ACE scores, partly because there's a lot of treatment people in this room. There's a lot of people who work with both adolescents, very young people. And the ACE scores, people in therapy know this term, right, ACE scores? Some people are nodding their heads. So Kaiser did a really great study in early 2000s. And Kaiser, as you know, like they own California Healthcare. They do amazing studies. They can do whatever they want. And so they surveyed 19,000 kids, and these are white middle-class kids. And they asked 10 very simple questions. And the 10 questions I actually now administer to most of my patients because it helps me understand where they're coming from and it helps me understand why I'm getting, why they're not doing better, why they're not actually managing their diabetes better or their hypertension better. This informs how it is I understand what's going wrong with them more than anything else I do. And so I'm not going to read all of these questions aloud. I'm just going to read some of them, but, you know, did... a parent or another adult in your household often or very often push, grab, slap, or throw something at you? Did you often or very often feel that you didn't have enough to eat, had to wear dirty clothes, and had no one to protect you? Or that your parents were too drunk or high to take care of you or take you to the doctor if you needed? Like this is a list of 10 things that none of us would want to have to happen to our children. Not a single one of these things. We will work to the ends of the earth to protect our children from this. But if you actually perform this little quiz, 10-question quiz on yourself, I'm not going to be surprised if lots of us in this room score on this, and some of us actually score quite high. Because this is a measure that looks at abuse, neglect, and household dysfunction, and what it means long-term in terms of health outcomes. It has very, very high prediction for chronic pain, for addiction. It has very high prediction for heart disease, cancer, just mortality overall, like an earlier death rate by 7 to 10 years. The study blew people's socks off because no one paid attention to the terrible things that happened during childhood and what it means for you and your body and your brain for the rest of your life. If you take a child and make them fear for their lives, make them wonder who's going to feed them, who's going to be home to take care of their baby sister, you will take a child living under a tremendous amount of stress, and that stress in their body can often set them up for a lifetime of disease. And as you can imagine, when I was talking about the memory, the amygdala and the hippocampus, memory and emotion, you can imagine a tremendous amount of negative emotion hooking into bad memories and wanting to escape that, doing anything you can to run away from that. So if you don't, you know, look up the ACE score on your smartphone. It's a really interesting thing. The CDC has a huge component of their current healthcare plan focusing on adverse childhood events. And for those of you who are in healthcare or in treatment, you should do ACE scores on like everybody. If you're delivering babies, you should find out what happened to people's lives. One of the ways I find them most helpful is when I sit with somebody who's struggling with chronic pain, let's say, and they score a 7, I sit there with them, and I often had no idea what had happened to them as a child. I'm horrified. I move to tears every visit because it's so upsetting. But I also look at them and say, I also know you're a great father, and you will do everything in your power to ensure that our children are not subjected to that. And for those of you in this room that work on protecting our children's lives, this is one of the most important investments we can make. So which came first, right? Are people born with low dopamine levels? Do we put them into miserable, stressful situations where their dopamine levels get altered, or where actually we need to quiet down that amygdala and hippocampus because we can't bear the emotional pain that we suffer in? The truth is, I have no idea, right? This is going to get figured out over time. I do think some of us, we know genetically, are predisposed, but I think you could take the perfect genetics and you could screw it up with a terrible environment. You could have a perfect environment and have some genetics play. It's a complicated story. I covered this a little bit earlier. One of the other things I want to say about transferring addiction, the other place we see it a lot, is for people who have a food addiction. So women in particular, less so for men who have had gastric bypass surgery, often develop an addiction to something. They'll often start smoking. They'll often get addicted to their opiate pain medicines. It's one of those things for those of us that work with people who have had gastric bypass, you've got to be paying attention. You should be paying attention to it all the time. When you're helping somebody with their disease of addiction, you should be asking yourself, where's it going? What else is happening? Do I care that they're becoming an obsessive marathon runner? Maybe not. I mean, I do. I love it when my people end up at the gym and they're working out a couple hours a day. I don't want them to go over the top, but give me a couple hours of exercise a day. Who doesn't want that? So I want to make this point, and I can't make it enough, but drug dependence is a chronic medical illness like every other chronic disease. And there was a day a couple weeks ago where I had two women come in, actually a guy and a woman. They'd gone off all their diabetes medicine. They'd stopped their insulin. Their hemoglobin A1C was in the toilet. They're spilling sugars. They're ketotic. They're train wrecks. And I'm like, wow, what happened to you? How'd you stop your insulin? And they told me their stories. And what did I do for them? I got them free insulin. I got them needles. I had a diabetes educator come down. I'm, working coupons at the pharmacy. I'm doing everything I can to recognize that for some reason they fell off the wagon and they stopped their insulin. I didn't shame them for it. But my last guy of the day, he'd been doing great for 9 months. He was my gold star guy, but he'd relapsed. And the truth is, I was disappointed. I was upset with him because he had been my gold star for 9 months. And 9 months, for some reason, with the opiates, is this place where I often find that people fall off again. And the truth is, in my own mind, I was like, wow, I cannot play this game of shaming and blaming, because the relapse rate with diabetes is about, what does it say here, 30 to 50%. With hypertension, 50 to 70% of us don't take our blood pressure meds or follow up with our appointments or come in and have our metabolic panel checked. And with asthma, the rates of actually taking your asthma medicines as directed, about 30% of them actually do. So how is addiction any different a disease than all of these other chronic medical diseases where people struggle because it is hard? It's hard to manage your diabetes. It's hard to go out and lose weight, right? It's hard if you're a kid and you're a mom who hates sitting there with that stupid little inhaler and forcing your kid to sit still long enough to take it. So I find this to be a very helpful slide when I'm trying to convince primary care providers to recognize that this disease is like every other disease they take care of. It's challenging work. The most important thing is length of treatment, and I cannot say that enough. The research is unequivocal. Good outcomes depend on adequate treatment length, period. So the normal brain is that top PET scan, so lots of nice yellow and orange looking so happy. And then you look at 10 days of abstinence, and this is specifically in this slide, it's cocaine that is being looked at. So you see 10 days, there's not a lot of light up there, but then you look at 100 days, so that's over 3 months of abstinence. Those bottom brains, they don't look very good. Nobody in this room wants one of those bottom brains. The problem, though, that we have with the opiate epidemic currently is that we are applying the same rules with alcohol addiction to opiates. So we're going to admit you to the hospital or into a detox. We're going to give you some meds so you don't have a seizure or enter into the DTs and possibly die. We're going to give you 3 to 5, maybe 7 days of treatment for your detox like we do with alcohol, and you'll be fine. And the truth is, as we all know in this room, and we cannot say it enough, and I don't ever want another detox bed to be opened. I don't want a single dollar being spent on detox for opiates because, quite honestly, there's no evidence supporting it, and what there is clear evidence of harm. You get people off their opiates just long enough that they come out, relapse, and are going to die. It is the worst thing we can do for people. You can name it something else. You could say, I'm going to hold on to your kid for the next 5 days till I can find them a better treatment plan. It's like just stabilization. So if everybody can stop using that word detox, or if somebody uses it, just tell them you're not detoxing them from anything. This is a process when it comes to the opiates that we're talking 9, 15, 24 months of time. It takes a long time to get better. Not that it takes a fast time to heal yourself from alcoholism either, but the acute medical detox really can be 5-7 days, and then you're going to struggle with your disease for a lot longer than that. This is just an article because Europe's much better than we are, but one of the things I argue for all the time is a therapeutic community. And in the perfect world, where we all just sit down together and write up our perfect world where people could get the best treatment possible, and the treatment that most of you would want for your kids, is you would pack them up and put them in a loving, safe place that was filled with multiple well-proven modalities to take care of them. They would also have medicine if they needed it for medicine-assisted treatment. They would also have urine drug screen. They would have my sister being the tough nurse who managed them. They would have very specific, you know, dialectical behavioral therapy, acceptance, commitment, treatment, ACT treatment. This is all stuff that's happening in the Franklin County House of Corrections and is being done very, very well. Acupuncture has been well studied for the disease of addiction as being helpful. Who's paying for acupuncture, right? That's not happening. Should it? Of course it should. And peer-to-peer recovery, recovery coaches working together with others who are also struggling. In our perfect little house somewhere, and we'll need several hundred or thousand of these houses, people will live together and they will work to stay sober in an environment that is not at all familiar from the environment they were using, right? And so I always say it, I want to pack up all my kids and I want to ship them to Bristol County and I'll take all those kids from Suffolk County. We need to shuffle people around because returning back to where you used to use, it will not work. So as with any addiction, there are medicines that can help you. So if you struggle with nicotine, there's a patch, there's a gum, there's a nasal spray. You can use bupropion, which is Wellbutrin. You can use varenicline, which I can't pronounce because it's actually Chantix. I never use the generic on that one. So that's stuff that your doctor, if you smoke, has offered you. I hope they have because we try to do that aggressively. So those are drugs that help replace the nicotine receptor in your brain, right? Everybody who smokes has been offered that. There's no shame in that. We want you to stop smoking. For alcohol use, there are medicines that we use to help people stay away from alcohol. Some of them are aversive drugs, meaning that like the disulfiramine, which is antabuse, if you take it and then you drink, you'll get wicked sick. So it makes you not want to drink because you don't really want to be wicked sick. The other medicines in that category, I won't cover all of them, but there's very good evidence that looks at naltrexone, both the oral form and the long-acting injectable form, as being very effective to reduce the cravings for alcohol. And then for opiate use disorder. So again, I'm just trying to remind people, addiction, three different kinds of addictions to chemicals, and there are meds used. So people get all up in arms about methadone or buprenorphine or buprenorphine plus naloxone, also called Suboxone or Subutex. But these are medicines that help replace what the opiate receptor is craving in the brain. They buy you time so your brain can get better. We're going to spend a minute talking about alcohol because actually one of the most costly diseases of addiction in our society is alcoholism. And I know we talk a lot about the amount of opiates that's at the Franklin County House of Corrections or that's in our courthouse, but I'd actually like to see the numbers. I think half of it is alcohol. When you read the police logs, when you read what's happening in the courts, there are a huge number of OUIs. Alcohol costs people a huge amount of harm to themselves physically. It's actually a very is a disease that ravages the body. It also destroys families, and it puts a lot of people at risk on the roads. So the disease of alcohol is amongst us, and it's the one that I would say that most medical professionals miss. So a third of us drink nothing in this country, and a third of us drink a little bit, maybe a drink and a half a week. The top 10% of us in this country drink, on average, 7 to 9 drinks a day. Now, I can tell you, I cannot name 10% of my patients who are drinking 7 to 9 drinks a day. And it's not because I don't have the drinkers in my population. It's because I can't figure it out. Because it involves somebody coming in and me asking the exact right question at the right time and then being able to tell me, right? Because it's a hard thing for any of us to admit to. So, you know, I do think that alcohol, we have to pay attention to this. It happens to our kids, but it happens to those of us in this room. And we're self-medicating. We're medicating for stress, for misery. So pay attention to that one. So when you look at the leading causes of death, we always can list the fact that heart disease is going to kill you more than anything else, and then there's cancer, and then there's stroke. But really, really, what actually causes people to die, when you look at that orange chart, it's tobacco. The number one reason that people get heart disease, cancer, have a stroke, or chronic lower respiratory disease is tobacco. I hate tobacco, and if I could ban it, I would. I know we'd have an illegal trade, but honestly, the legal age to buy tobacco in this country should be 25, period. And people should be arrested for buying it for people to minors, because this is a disease that if it doesn't hit you when you're young, you will never smoke. So poor diet and physical inactivity is the second leading cause of death, but the third is alcohol consumption. I wanted to make that point to people that two of the top three leading causes of death in this country are related to substances. This is actually from Marisa because it's such a great public health graph, and it shows in the negative column all of these diseases where we've actually gotten really good. We're really good at taking care of pregnant women. We reduce the amount of death that happens to pregnant women. We vaccinate pretty darn well in this country, and so we've reduced pneumonia, we reduce flu. Because cars are so much safer and we mandate seatbelts, motor vehicle accidents are way down. So that's good public health measures, right? That's not what I did in my office. That's all public health stuff. And then you look at the places where we've increased the amount of people dying, and almost everything there outside of suicide is actually old age related, because guess what? We all get to live a really long time now, and eventually something's going to get you, right? So Parkinson's, Alzheimer's disease, your kidneys just fail after a while because kidneys at 99 years old are pretty tired. But the most upsetting one there is the 276% increase in opiate overdose deaths. I think this is an interesting slide. It's a complicated graph, is what I will say. It's a graph like I'd never seen. But what it does is it says, how addictive are drugs in general? If you smoke, let's say, marijuana, how likely are you to get addicted to marijuana? Marijuana, interestingly, is not a particularly addictive drug. There are addictions with marijuana, but only 9% of people who start using marijuana will actually get addicted to it. The highest addictive thing is actually nicotine. So a third of people, 33% of people who start smoking, 32% on this graph, will become addicted to nicotine. There's lots of us who tried one or two, but then we didn't go on. But that has a very high addictive potential. Heroin, on the other hand, is 23% addictive. So there are people who try it and never go back. I guess that's good. I don't see those people, but they exist, right? What is the most addictive on this little slide? 94% of rats that were exposed to sugar got addicted. So I want to spend a minute just talking about the meds a little bit more clearly, because I do think there is, in both the recovery community, in the general community, and absolutely in the medical community, a lot of antipathy towards the medicines that we use that help people with their disease of addiction. And I want to just be clear, I'm not wedded to anything, quite honestly. I'm wedded to whatever it's going to take to make you better. And I think that all the time. I look at my patients and I think, what else can we do? What else should we try? Where else can we go? Because I don't have a single method to fix this problem. We got to find the five different things that are going to work for you. And I need everybody to stay open-minded, right? I need people to recognize that for some people, methadone is the most effective drug for them, and we need to get them access to methadone and not be one of the 23 states that limit the amount of time you can be on it to 3 months. That's crazy. 3 months of methadone gets you nowhere. So methadone is a full agonist. It fills those little opiate receptors in the brain entirely. Buprenorphine is a partial agonist, so it blocks it, but it doesn't really fill it. And then the antagonist, or the real blocker to the cravings, is naloxone. People often know it by the injectable brand name of Vivitrol. I'm not going to torture you with this, but again, the way that buprenorphine works is it sort of fills the receptor. It prevents another opiate from getting in there. You can't get terribly high on it, although a lot of people do get high on it, and that's where a lot of the pushback comes. I think if you're going to work to get high on something and you use enough of buprenorphine, whether you're injecting it, which is how people would abuse it, you can get high. Even if it has naloxone in it, and I had to ask my Suboxone rep how it worked because I just didn't understand how naloxone could be on board and you could still get high. But naloxone has a short half-life and buprenorphine has a long one. And if you can just ride out that time of sickness, the high will come. So I'm not going to spend time on this, but methadone just keeps people's opiate receptors filled and even, and the cravings are gone. When you do a head-to-head study on buprenorphine and methadone, the upside to methadone is it's incredibly structured. So people who have long-term abuse, who have very high use, who are really, really struggling, methadone is a really, really good option. And thank God we have a methadone clinic in this town. It's a good thing. Buprenorphine, it's more convenient. You can still go to school. You can go to work. You don't have to wake up at 6:30 in the morning and have to have a long drive to go pick up your drug. People can resume their lives better. And I actually think it's been part of the problem with buprenorphine is that people resume their lives so normally that you don't know they're on it. And so one of the conversations we've been having in the recovery community is they'll argue with me, I don't see this drug working. All I do is see people abusing it. And I'll say, well, you don't see the 73 people I take care of who will say that this drug saved their lives, and they're at work, and they're raising their kids, and they're volunteering in the community, and their lives are so back on track. But you're right, they're not showing up at your meetings, they're not showing up at this meeting. They have become sort of quiet and no longer ostracized and not stigmatized because this medicine has given them their lives back. They're quiet is what I will say. And I need them to be a little bit more outspoken because I need there to be more open minds about all the different ways we can treat people. Overall retention rates at a year with both methadone and Suboxone, for methadone it's 60%, for Suboxone it's 50%. So those are pretty good rates, right? I know that seems kind of pathetic, but in medicine, 50 or 60%, that's awesome. When I give somebody an antidepressant, I don't think it's going to work 50% of the time. And I give them an antibiotic, I don't think it's going to work that much. There's very few things that are quite that effective. They're pretty good. They work. This is just a similar slide that shows, in this case, they said a 60% retention at year one. This is a study, and the reason I included it here is I wanted to spend a minute talking about that slide I showed you of the guy with the heart attack and the woman who overdosed. So this is a study that came out of JAMA just 4 weeks ago, and it came out of Yale, which is where I went to medical school, and I knew the people that ran the study. And what they did in their ER was a little different. They did it over 4 years, and ER people would come in, and they would have had an opiate problem. Some of them would have overdosed. And the first group just had screening. The next group had screening and brief intervention, and the third group really had screening, brief intervention, and treatment. And what did they do with treatment? They said, hi, you're really struggling. I'm giving you a 7-day prescription for Suboxone, and I'm giving you a follow-up appointment with somebody who dispenses Suboxone. That group, at the end of 1 month, 80% of them were not using opiates, and they were actually using their Suboxone as prescribed. Now again, small study, I'm only looking at 1 month, but I can tell you it's a lot better than sending somebody out that door after 4 hours with no treatment plan in place. So my intention was to show this to the ER at the hospital because I was mad and I was excited about the study, but nobody from the ER showed up in my talk. So I'm going to have to hunt them all down. This is a slide that I love, and I'm almost done here. I want this to stay in people's minds. And this looks at sort of recovery in general, and it brings us back to that concept that I said earlier. The thing that works the best is time. Giving people time to let their brains heal, to let dopamine normalize again, because guess what? Unless you've been using drugs and alcohol for 30 or 40 years, I actually think those people maybe can't renormalize their brains, because I do take care of some of those patients. But if you've been using for a much shorter amount of time than that, your brain can develop new opiate receptors. It can develop new recyclers. You could make more dopamine. You do it by making connections to people, by loving people, by taking care of your children and planting a garden, volunteering in the community, having a pet, working and feeling like you're an active person in society. That heals your brain, but it takes time for that to happen. So in this slide, what it shows is that 74% of people in the first year will relapse. That's just the way it is. So in the first year, you should expect 3/4 of the people to relapse. If people are able to maintain sobriety for 1 to 3 years, 66% of them will be able to hold that. A third will relapse. Once you get yourself to the 3 to 5 year marker, or specifically the 5 year marker, you get to 86% long-term recovery. So the rates of relapse are 14%. We need time on our side. We need time to help people heal. And so again, these public policy statements that I get from these insurance companies that said, oh, no, we're going to limit the amount of time you can use these medicines. You can use them for 3 or 6 months. And I'm thinking, who are you and what do you know about this disease to be telling me how long I could treat this person? And I fight like crazy with them, but they're the insurance company and they cut them off, and these drugs cost a lot of money. Or again, my example with many of the states in this country that limit the amount of time that you can use methadone, right? We're talking people need to be living in a sober situation, and particularly young people in sober housing, for months and months and months and months for them to get better. The upside I'm going to say about adolescents using drugs is they also recover. They really recover, and they recover faster. I don't have any data to support me on that one per se, but in my clinical experience, the drugs that have been, the young people whose brains are still in active development and then get off the drugs, they truly get better back to fairly normal brains, and it's extraordinary. And that's where all of our efforts should be placed, is to help all of us get better. So that is actually, I think, the end of my talk.